Good morning and welcome all on this beautiful spring day. I'm going to begin by reading a statement regarding Zoom, and it reads as follows. Pursuant to current state law, this meeting of the Council on Aging in Bedford is being conducted via remote participation. Excuse me. Persons who would like to listen or view this meeting while in progress may do so by Zoom or by phone.
This meeting,
I'm sorry. This meeting is being recorded by the town of Bedford. All votes taken by this body shall be by roll call. Okay. Now we'll take the roll. Gene?
Here.
Lou?
Yep.
Sandra?
Here.
And Tom?
Here.
And Bobby?
Here.
I'm sorry you couldn't get the video to work, Bobby.
This is the only Zoom connection link that I have trouble with.
Yeah, me too.
I don't know. Anyhow, I'm here on the phone.
Terrific. Glad to have you. Okay.
Now you forgot Cindy.
Oh, did I?
I'm here.
Sorry, Cindy.
That's all right.
Okay, so we've got everyone, I believe.
Is that Mary Lou?
Right?
Mary Lou, yes, in here today.
Yeah, right. Mary Lou had indicated to me beforehand that she wasn't going to be unable to be here today. So we're 7-0. Is that right? Yep. Okay. Just a few words from my remarks. I would also indicate, in addition to Mary Lou, Bopa has already indicated to me that she would be unable to be here today as well, as the liaison to us from the select board. I thought it'd be worth noting to that she was not here today. The next item that I had is that it's coming up to the end of this fiscal year, which ends June 30th. And it's necessary for us to select officers for next year. In so doing, I'm going to appoint a nominating committee to develop the slate and present it to us. And that will consist of myself, and Sandra has agreed to serve with me. The bylaws or the rules indicate that it's two members of the board. So we've complied with that. The necessity of doing all this is that we need to develop a slate of candidates for office before the June board meeting. The June board meeting is June 13th, I believe. I wrote that down. Check me on that, but I believe it was June 13th is the date.
Yes, it is.
Yep, there it is. I knew I'd written it down somewhere. So we want to submit to you all the candidate slate sometime 2 weeks at least before that meeting. So with that in mind, I would just say to all of you if you have any interest in serving as an officer, to let myself know or Sandra. Otherwise, we're going to be out and about trying to develop the slate. Okay. So the next item.
Alan, could I interrupt just for a moment? I'm sorry, I had my hand up.
Oh, I'm sorry, I couldn't see it.
Yeah, that's okay. Do we have a clerk? Because I don't see anybody writing. And you are. Okay. I just didn't see anybody. Thank you.
Yeah, it's Jean. Okay. I'm also going to ask each of you who have been facilitators of the topics that we've done the last few months and that will now for the remainder of this year. I'm asking you to please develop a brief statement, narrative written of a paragraph to a few paragraphs indicating what your topic was and what existed, if can be identified, what your group was involved with at the time of our meeting, and what you developed from it, what next steps you might have identified. All of that would be helpful as Allison and I prepare the yearly report. So if you could do that before June 13th, that should give you plenty of time, but I hope it won't be an onerous task, but if you can, please do so. Sandra, you have your hand up.
Thank you. So the yearly report being the town report or a yearly report on the COA board?
The town report.
Okay, great. Thanks. Because I know the one from last year just came out.
Yeah.
So we're already on to the next one. I just wanted to clarify. Thank you.
Yeah. Allison, I believe we also submit that report to the EOEA. Is that correct?
Yes, the one I do for the town.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
As part of the formula grant application.
Yeah. I thought so. Okay. All right. Any questions on that?
Where else did it get submitted beside the town? You said the AOE? Yeah.
EOEA, Executive Office.
Okay.
Did you get it, Gene?
Yeah.
Okay. Now then. I think the next item on our agenda is the minutes from the March 28th meeting, which Allison and I have not been able to finalize in time to be posted for this meeting. So therefore, that reference will be on hold. And we will take up the March 28th minutes at our next meeting in May. Okay. Now then, next item is Allison's comments today. Okay. All yours, Allison.
Thank you. Hello, everybody. It's April, believe it or not. So this past Saturday, we had our Jacob Renthrop Morton Art Show, which was really well attended, some great art pieces there. And it does raise money for art programs for the next year. So this year we're going to offer ukulele classes that start in May. We already have 9 people signed up. So this is really a great opportunity to remember Jacob and everybody that we've lost over the years too, and also celebrate art and get funding for future art programs, which is really great. For me, it is the time of year where we do the staff reviews. So, you know, it's a busy time for us. So if you don't hear back from me straight away, that's probably why. In March, we had about 80 people a day on my monthly report. I summarize everything. So we're up to 80. Before COVID, we were 100. So we're not far off. And then in May, the lunches with Carton Woolard are going to be returning as well. So that's 40 people on a Monday and a Wednesday and a Friday. So that'll increase our attendance as well. So we'll be back up to our 100 and up probably over in May. So definitely much busier. We're going to launch the Mass Challenge. I don't know if you participated last year, but we counted our steps and completed MCOA challenges, which were steps and won some prizes, which was really nice. So we're offering that and also opening up a new program called Walkie Talkies for people who just want to walk with others and have a chat. We do have our hikers back and our bikers back, so everybody's very busy outside, but we wanted to offer a, you know, not a hike, not a heavy walk, just a small one if people wanted to walk around. So you'll see that in the May newsletter. We had our Holy Lunch at the end of May, which went really well attended. There was an educational piece and the room was full. So it was a good test of what that room could look like with lunches, because that's where we're going to be for our Carton Woolard lunch. And last but not least, you probably heard the town manager did give her notice. So she's working part-time now, and the select board announced last night their process to hire a new town manager. So Colleen Doyle is the acting for now, who's our HR and assistant town manager. So it'll be a bit of a change for us, but we wish Sarah all the best with her new career. So does anyone have any questions for me about the monthly report or the financials or anything that was sent over to you this time? Sandra, hand up.
Yeah, I was just interested in the walkie-talkie thing, which sounds really great. And I guess there'll be more information in the upcoming newsletter. But so people are just going to kind of self-organize around that? Or how is that? Is there going to be a sign-up for different times? Or
yeah, so we're going to help people sign up for the Mass Challenge online. So there's an online thing. We've got a whole system that we're going to help people do. And then when people come, if they want to join the walkie-talkies, we can ask the group what's the preferred time. So it could be one group, two groups, it could be a few groups. We just want to offer something for people who want to meet here and just do a small around the campus kind of walk, collect their steps and then come back to the COA. So we haven't quite got it all fleshed out yet, but yes, we're hoping to get a few people joined. You know, depends on the day, depends on the weather, you never know. But yeah, you do have to have a schedule. So yes, we'll be thinking about that too.
Okay, great. Yeah, I wasn't sure if it was an ongoing thing or just for the Mass Challenge.
But we want to keep it going. We wanted to talk anyway, but the Mass Challenge was a nice way for us to kick it off as well. So it's a
great. Thanks.
Allison, if I may have missed it, but when is this affair?
So the Mass Challenge opens now, so we can help people sign up between now and October. So it's through Massachusetts Council on Aging. We did apply for a kickoff event. They were offering to do a kickoff event for us. We didn't win that grant, so we were going to do our own. And it's really wonderful. There's lots of different challenges. So I'm going to do the seashore challenge, which is this many miles from, you don't walk the seashore, but with your steps, that's as many as you have. There's lots of different ones. They've added a lot more challenges this year too. And you choose whichever one you want to do. And then you just keep putting your steps in every day and collect the numbers. And it helps get outside. It helps get you healthy. And if you've got some great counts, you get, you know, we've had gift cards sent here for people who've participated. Sometimes there's a water bottle or something sent. It's just an incentive to get people out and walking around. And we thought walkie-talkies might be a nice way to have people who want to chat with other people and just walk. So that's a new thing that we're trying this month. Any questions on any of the other stuff? Okay. Thank you.
Very good. And now we're going to move to the key element here today, the topic of transportation in Bedford. And I'm going to turn to Tom and Lou. I don't know who wants to start here.
Well, I went back into the archives to get a lot of information from the publication that you paid to have done a couple of years ago.
Yep.
And what I found out, because I already knew that there's not much available for public transportation in town. We've got options, taxis, BLT, and Dash, and the MBTA ride. With few of the people in town use most of these, and another mode of transportation was biking and walking, and the need for safe sidewalks, etc. And not much else for transportation in town, especially if you live out where I do, out in the boonies. But I'm lucky I'm able to continue driving, because if I couldn't, I'd have a hard time getting around. So Tom, you got anything?
Yeah, I have a document I put together and a presentation based on it that covers some of that. Dash, unfortunately, bit the dust a couple of years ago, so it's no longer a part of our world. BLT has some changes, and the MBTA stuff has some changes. So I'll try to cover that.
Tom, is there any way for you to speak louder? I can't quite, I'm having trouble hearing.
Allison, you said that you would show these on the screen for me. I mean, I was expecting to do that, except for the fact that with my video breaking up the way it is, I think that would be thoroughly confusing for me and for you as well. So if you could.
Which one, Tom? Which one would you like? Transport and aging, or transport and seniors?
The one that's the bulleted points, the presentation thing. It's a DocX document, so you'll just have to scroll down through it.
But it's I think I found it.
There we go. Okay. So that's just an identifying bit. You scroll down to the next page. The interesting point that we're getting older, but we're still going places. If there's anybody in this group who is still breathing and not getting older, forget my presentation. Let's hear yours. I think, however, that this pretty well describes the situation. So many of us are driving. Some of us are doing limited driving, which means that we need somebody else to do it sometimes. And then some people need someone else to drive all the time. So in addition to that, we have some door-to-door questions we need to answer. So let's talk briefly about driving as a senior. Next page. In the past, the COA has had several sessions which were quite interesting on safe driving for seniors, and also explaining these safety-related features on new cars, because there are things that weren't there on the cars we grew up driving and getting our own licenses with a long time ago. So we need to think about whether or not we would like to hold one or more of those sessions again. I think it would be probably a worthwhile thing to do at this point. Driving also means dealing with the registry of motor vehicles, which is always a fun exercise. And it's especially relevant to things like driver's license renewals. I'm going to try to, I can't do it. I can't fix the screw up on my screen up there. I think I will try to get rid of the this. I guess that was not it. I'm trying to get back my
We can hear you, Tom.
Yeah, I'm trying to get back to this thing, to the text the bullet points so that people can see them. And I'm not finding what's going to do that.
It's still on our screen. We can see, we can still see it, Tom.
You can see, I don't want you to see me. I want you to be able to see the bullet points. Can you see them?
Yes, yeah. they're on the screen share. They're the big thing on the screen.
Yeah. They're simply not on my screen anymore. That's
you can talk through your points if you still have it on paper, and I'll just follow along with the screen share.
Yeah, well, I do have it on paper.
Okay, then just follow through. I can just scroll through when you get to the bit you want to get to.
Okay.
Yep.
Driver's license renewals these days, if you're 75 or older, have to be done in person. That will always include a vision test. It may require a driving test, but it seldom does. So you need to think about the question of, if they ask for one, could you do it? Can you back into a spot? Can you parallel park? Can you do those things with or without the backup camera that you may or may not be accustomed to? And can you use your own car for it? Because there's an interesting little requirement from the RMD that says that the examiner has to be able to reach your emergency brake if it's necessary to do so, which means that from the passenger seat, one must be able to activate the emergency brake. And you know, most of us remember the cars that had those where you put your left foot on a pedal or something like that. Clearly that is not accessible to the examiner. Therefore, you would have to get another car and do your driver's test. It's just something to think about. In addition to that, you need to deal with the question of, do you have a real ID driver's license? Do you know what that is? How many of you actually do have real ID licenses? Anybody?
I do. Yeah. I do. And actually, they keep postponing the deadline for that. Some people think that will never go into effect.
So I know they keep postponing it. I'm not so sure about the never going into effect. The RMD has seniors' hours. You may not have been aware of that. And I have read what they are exactly and couldn't put my hands or eyes back on the exact information about that. So it's something I owe you. From my perspective, the nearest RMD office is probably the one in Wilmington, which is on Route 62 to go eastbound. And it's very easy to get to. The RMD has a Massachusetts driver's manual, which you can easily download and read if you do, or search. If you decide to print it, be warned that it's somewhere between 162 and 170 pages long. So you may want to think twice before you start printing. Let's go on to riding with someone else driving. Back in November 26, 2018, Louise St. Germain's, and there's my second typo, it's not Sat Germain's, it's St. Germain's, COA presentation was called Not Driving, Now What? And she made the interesting point that the biggest single change that you have to cope with once you're not driving anymore is the incredibly increased amount of planning that is required. I mean, if I want to go to CVS or Stop and Shop or Market Basket or the library or downtown, I just get in the car and go. You can't do that if you're not driving anymore. So it requires a lot more planning. There are a number of options, as Lou was indicating earlier, and I've listed some of them here. We'll talk about them. The BLT, medical rides from the COA, taxi cabs, which do still exist, Uber and Lyft, and Go-Go Grandfather, and then the MBTA stuff. It's trains, subways, buses, the ride, and the ride flex. and I'm sure there are more. Lou, you mentioned a couple that are not on my list. So, you know, whatever's not on my list, you need to add to it. Let's talk about the BLT. It's our Bedford Local Transit. It's our local transportation service. It's a new and handicapped accessible van. It's available to any Bedford resident, not just senior citizens. For us as riders over 65, the $1 a ride in town and $2 a ride out of town, that can be decreased by buying for $20 a book of tickets or a BLT card worth $25 worth of rides. At present, it operates as a deviated fixed route service, a curious phrase, which means in the first place, as far as fixed route is concerned, is that it has to have a fixed route schedule, which of course can differ from day to day, but it's got to have one. And it has to travel that route. The deviated part means that it can deviate from there to make the pickups and the drop-offs if you live someplace that's not on the route. In theory, you could go to any stop on the scheduled route and get on the BLT, and maybe you can actually do that. However, if people have booked the seats and they've done that by calling before 7 o'clock in the morning to reserve a place on there, there may not be a seat for you if you just show up at the bus stop. So be careful about that. If you want to reserve a seat, you call by 7 o'clock in the morning at 781-275-2255, which is the BLT phone number. You need to call that number too to get the current schedule, since they do change. And it is my impression that as of July 1st, it may no longer have this deviated fixed route service structure. Is that correct, Allison? Does that change in July?
I had applied for the grant. The grantee's MBTA retracted the grant, and we have to apply again. But that is the goal, to have this be more of an on-demand, because that's really what the town needs.
Right.
But I don't have a time frame, so.
Yeah, so much of the detail in here doesn't apply after July 1st, if we can get that, but it will be much more useful for us because it goes where people need it to go rather than on a fixed route, which may be quite irrelevant on a given day. Medical rides from the COA, another topic. You can get those by calling the COA directly. The COA will book the ride with Bedford Coach, and for medical appointments, the COA will pay for it. Now, that's what I know about this topic. I got that by interviewing our friend Bruce Mountain Stalker, who uses it that way all the time. Is there much more to it than that? I don't think it's much more complicated than that, is it? Another topic is cab companies. They do still exist. Bedford Coach is at 781-275-5000. You can easily go online into Google or something and ask for cabs near Bedford, Mass, and you will get several others in Burlington and Billerica. By and large, if you book it, you're paying for it. And during your booking call, there are several things you should nail down. What's the fare, at least approximately? What forms of payment are they accepting? What, if any, door-to-door service is available to you? And by the way, can you get into and out of a small automobile, or do you need something larger? You need to clarify those when you book the ride. because if they're important, they are critically important. And the next thing is Uber and Lyft, which are, that's the next thing here, companies that provide taxi cab-like services. They require you to set up an account with them, and they are basically designed to work with their cell phone apps. And as far as their preferences are concerned, that's the way you would use them, period. They do have a few exceptions. Uber, for example, can be accessed from a PC or a laptop. All you have to do is go to the website, m.uber.com, and you can use it just like you were using the Uber app on your cell phone. Lyft allows you to book rides by calling on the telephone. Uber does not. Uber has no facility to do that. But there's an organization called GoGo Grandparent, phone number of which is there, which provides an intermediary service, which allows you to simply make a phone call, tell them what kind of thing you need, and you can very simply and easily book an Uber ride without having or using a cell phone. Each of these two provides various classes of service, and the basic one from Uber is called UberX. The basic one from Lyft is just called LyftX, Lyft with no X. And those just provide you with a car, somebody's car, probably a regular size car. It could be a Prius, could be a Dodge Charger, could be anything. And it handles 1 to 4 people and on a very limited basis, a suitcase or a small carry-on or something. If you need more room, either so you can get in or out, or you need some more space to put your shopping packages or your luggage or whatever, you should ask for Uber XL or Lyft XL. Those simply give you a bigger vehicle. Same service, a bigger vehicle. Of course, it costs more, but that way you can have room for your stuff or yourself if you need more. There is a site called Ridester, which I gave the website address for here. It's got a huge amount of information about these ride-sharing services. And it covers something like 60 of them, not just Uber and Lyft. The other 58 you've probably never heard of. And let's see here. I get so confused here with my paper copy. Well, I guess that's it. Ridester is a very confusing site because there's so much in it. But if you need to ask questions about Uber or Lyft, you should try to get familiar with using it because everything is in there somewhere. It just may take a bit of work to find it. That brings us on to the MBTA itself. And they run trains and they run buses. Bedford has not had train service from the MBTA since the 1970s, but presumably you could get to train stations in North Billerica or Wilmington or Concord and take the train into Boston or outbound to somewhere else from that location. Of course, that doesn't solve your driving problem. It just means you've got to somehow get to those stations. MBTA buses, of course, represent the reason that Bedford is associated at all with the MBTA. That's the thing that provides MBTA service in this town, and therefore that's what makes us eligible for things like the ride and all that. There is a 62/76 bus that runs between Alewife and the Bedford VA hospital. Once upon a time in the old days, those were two separate bus lines, each of which had a relatively sensible route that it followed. Now they've been combined into one long contorted route. And if you go online and look at the schedule, there are potentially 68 intervening stops between Alewife and the Bedford VA. Have fun. The trip is scheduled to take about an hour and 50 minutes each way, and the buses depart from each end 12 times a day at roughly 1 hour intervals. Now, if they departed 12 times a day, as shown here, from say 7 a.m. to 7 p.m., that would take 13 bus trips, not 12. So in the middle, it's not quite once an hour, but you know that's changing all the time anyway, so you can look that up on the schedule for the MBTA 6276 bus. It advertises the departure from the VA once an hour, roughly from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. Alewife is 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. Their advertising about this route mentions Hanscom Airport and Middlesex Community College, but neither of those is actually served by the bus route. So I'm not sure what those references should be taken to mean. It does provide a way to get from Bedford to Alewife Station. It does provide a way to get around on a limited basis within Bedford. And if you enter MBTA 62/76 bus into a search engine, you can get the current schedule and the current stops. As far as subways are concerned, the only one that's even faintly plausible from here is the red line out of the Alewife Station. And the final thing from the MBTA is the ride, which is a very important part of transportation for some people. It's an Americans with Disability Act compliant paratransit service for people with disabilities. And what that means here has to be explained a little bit. The purpose of the ride is to say that if you're in an area that has train, bus, or subway service from the MBTA, then you should be able to get around using that service. And if you cannot, because you are physically unable to use the service, then the MBTA will provide the ride to help you go places. And we are fortunate enough to be close enough in and to the MBTA area and directly served by the MBTA through that bus line. So we get services from the ride. Age has nothing to do with it. They don't care how old you are. Eligibility comes from applying, and they have a very stringent list of requirements. For example, can you walk 200 feet without a problem, that sort of thing. You will have to apply, and then you will have to be interviewed in person, and the requirements are quite strict. But once you have been accepted, then you set up an account, and you can book rides via TRAC, the Ride Access Center, and there's a phone number for it there. That account you set up will handle all of the billing and payment and so forth, and you have to keep enough money in the account to cover your rides. They are something like 3 1/4 and or 5.46 or some number like that per ride, depending on the exact categories of things. You can book the ride 1 to 5 days in advance. You must book the rides in advance. You must book it by 5 p.m. the day before the ride. And there are no same day bookings, period. So here's the cost on the next page. You don't necessarily have to travel it alone. If you want a friend to travel it with you, that's possible. You can also have an accompanying personal care assistant or one or two children, because remember, this is not necessarily for old people. This is for anybody who's got disability problems that keep them from using the regular MBTA. So those people may in fact have a child or two that needs to come with them. Here's a website that will give you everything you want to know about the ride. And I listed it for you. Something that is relatively new is something called the MBTA, the Ride Flex. If you're eligible to use the ride, then you can use the Ride Flex. What the Ride Flex does is it adds Uber and Lyft drivers to the drivers who can transport you as part of the ride. Now, you have to be able to cope with their doing that. I mean, the ride will always provide you with a wheelchair accessible van and all that. Uber and Lyft will seldom be able to do that. So you've got to make sure that an Uber car or a Lyft car would be suitable for you, or an Uber XL or Lyft XL vehicle would be suitable for you. What the Flex option does for the MBTA is it takes the burden, some of the burden off of the their specially equipped vans, so they don't have to be used for the ride trips that actually don't require all their special capabilities. And it adds to the number of drivers they've got. Now, last year, up through about the end of last year, there was a pilot program for this that's similar to what now exists as a formal program. But that was just the pilot. So if you were enrolled in it, you need to re-enroll in the real one as a separate process. And finally, the door-to-door considerations for these things. Drivers of the BLT van or the ride will help you get into and out of the vehicle. That's part of their job. And they will help you with your packages or luggage up to a point. Now for the ride, if you need them to carry some stuff from the vehicle to your front door, the ride driver can do that as long as it can be done in one trip. The ride driver will not do multiple trips to help you and then carry your stuff in separate trips. They will not go into your home or a building with you. Remember, however, that the cab drivers, the Uber drivers, and the Lyft drivers are under no particular legal obligation to do any of that sort of thing for you. All they're obligated to do is drive. Now, normally everybody knows that the cab driver or the Uber driver will help you put your suitcase in the car. It's entirely to their advantage to do that because it saves time. And if you're in the cab or Uber or Lyft driving business, time is money for you. But they are not obliged to do anything in particular. So if you need something in particular, you should set that up or discuss that ahead of time before you get in the car. Now, there are lots of things that I have not covered here. One of the things I realized late in the game that I've really given short shrift to is who pays for it and when, how much is it? So the cost issues associated with each of these should be added to this. We're going to do it as a presentation to the Council on Aging itself. But that's what I've got as far as transportation options. So questions, comments, whatever.
Well, Tom, I would start by Sandra? Saying, Tom?
Alan?
Yep. Sorry, my voice is weak. That's a very thorough discussion, and I appreciate that. I'm curious now from you and Lou, given the extent of the services that are available, what's missing? Anything?
Well, that's a good question. What is missing?
There's no plane service.
Private helicopter service is not there, Alan. You'll have to work on that. It's quite a lineup. And I think that you go back to Louis Saint-Germain's point, which was the real difference between driving and not driving is planning. Because if you're going to use these other services, you've got to put a lot of effort into thinking about your life ahead of time and planning, which some of us at least are not very good at. Now, Sandra, you had your hand up, and Cindy, you have a question.
I'll defer to Cindy, and then at some point go myself. Thanks.
Okay. Thanks, Sandra. The one thing I would just add to this presentation is that there's kind of a piece missing, I would say, in between the driving and not driving. There's modified driving. There's driving tests. So say somebody had a stroke or somebody had some sort of injury and they're not sure they're safe to drive and they're scared to drive. There are programs where you can actually be tested to see if you have all the skills necessary to drive. I also know a lot of times family members will get nervous about their, older family members driving. And they'll just want to take away the keys. What I always say is, why don't you do the test and get actual facts and find out if that is the right answer, because you don't want to take somebody's independence away if it's not necessary. There's also, again, if you had something, say a stroke is just an easy one that comes to mind, and you can only use one hand. There are modifications that can be made to a car so somebody can safely drive it and they can be taught how to do it through therapy. So, and they do it kind of modified in like a room, in a therapy room in the hospital somewhere. And they do it through computer programs and whatever. And then they'll bring you into a car and actually change it there too. So, I just wanted to bring that to light, that there are, that I would always, go through all the range that of things that you can do to stay independent before giving up driving, if that's something you really want to be able to continue to do.
That's a very good point. And actually, back when I was a kid, which was a very long time ago, I had an uncle who was paralyzed on one side from polio, and he had a car that had been modified so that he could drive it one-handed.
Right.
And he did that, and this would have been back in the 50s and 60s.
And there's so much more technology now and more gadgets and gizmos and things, it to make everybody safe. So it's pretty amazing. Yep.
Just don't believe that your Tesla is really a self-driving vehicle.
Yes, absolutely agree with that.
Those are very good points. Sandra?
Oh, thanks. So just a couple of overall thoughts. The website right now doesn't have any fixed route for the BLT. So it does talk a lot about fixed routes. So I don't know if there is one, but that might be something to add. I do notice that on the website about the BLT that it does say you call that day. It's in bold.
Yeah.
And then on the side, it says you can call up to 3 days ahead. So I'm wondering if we need to reconcile that.
It also implies that you could just go to a standard bus stop on that
right.
schedule and get on. And I don't know what that
right.
means. So maybe Allison, can you enter that? What's the story there? Is Allison still with us?
Yeah, while we're still in the current grant phase, we have to do the deviated fixed route. And the schedule should be attached on the very bottom, Sandra. It's not, it's not attached.
No, not there. No. That I could see. I didn't see it.
It might have been bumped when we had the web crossover.
Yeah.
So we do have the deviated still. And the point of the calling a few days ahead is if you do have a scheduled appointment, you can call ahead. And you can also call the same day. So maybe that's
clarifying. So I think it could be clear on the website. It's two different things in two different locations. So I think that would be helpful to clarify. Just on the Route 62 bus, Tom, a couple of updates on that. And also, during COVID, the Route 62 and 76 were combined. The 76 goes to Hanscom and a different way through Lexington, but they start out at Alewife going the same route. But anyway, that has changed back a little bit, and it's going to change further, I think, when and if the MBTA is able to hire enough drivers. But I just looked on the site, and 62 does have its own route for part of the day, and then at certain points they're combined, and they don't really take 2 hours. It's a scheduled for between half an hour and an hour. I haven't taken the bus since COVID, but it's never taken 2 hours. So I think that's really important to clarify, because that'll really discourage anybody from even thinking about it. It is 68 stops, but they only stop at, you know, when there's somebody at the stop. So granted, it's kind of awkward, but it's much better service, I think, than people might realize. And let's see, the MBTA does come out and train people in using public transportation to our community if we ever wanted that, including probably the ride. So that's a possibility. But I'd like to maybe not discourage people from taking the Route 62 bus, because it's really actually great to go through Bedford, go to the different shopping centers. I'm wondering if when we update this information, which is really amazing, that if we can post it somewhere on the website, maybe as a frequently asked questions thing or just a document, but it's helpful to have it all in one place. And just a really minor thing. At one point we still call it go-go grandfather, but I think it's go-go grandparent, and we should just make sure.
Okay. Yeah. I mistyped it as father on one slide.
Yeah.
And realized it was wrong and fixed it. But somewhere else I may have screwed it up.
Yeah. One other little point. You can make an appointment at the RMV now, and it's so easy. I mean, people all flock to AAA because they think it's easier. It's horrible. You have long lines. The RMV, you make an appointment, you walk right in. There are senior hours. I don't think you can make an appointment, so I haven't tried that, but it's probably lines there too because seniors are going. But you can just make an appointment and go, and it's just nobody there, and you walk right into your appointment, and it takes 5 minutes. So FYI, we might want to add that information about making an appointment.
I have a question, Alan.
Yep.
Alan, this is Bobby, and I have a question.
Yes, Bobby, go ahead.
Do we think maybe the COA can put a program on to explain this to the audience on what Sandra just said and what the presentation to explain about the buses, to get it out so people can be there and ask their own questions?
Yeah. It certainly seems like one of the next steps that should be taken. Tom, how do you feel about that?
Well, I think absolutely. I mean, I have never taken 62 bus from Bedford to Alewife. I'll admit that right now. It's sort of like Lou being the one of us who spends the most of his time actually at the COA interacting with the people who go there, much more than most of us do. And certainly I've never taken the ride. I've certainly taken the red line in from Alewife into town. I don't know how I feel about that at this point. Some of the problems they've had at the old life station and on the red line. But I mean, my level of personal experience with this is a limiting factor here and provides a lot of information that should be filled in.
Alan, I think Jean might have a really amazing idea that he's about to tell us about.
Yep, that's terrific. Yeah. Go ahead, Jean.
First of all, thanks, Tom. That was great. One of the things I was going to be talking about next month with the communication is I'm working with the Bedford TV on coming up with a series of short videos on the how-tos, and one of them would be how to use the BLT, how to use the ride, how to use the MBTA, just short little 5-10 minute videos that we can share and have people understand how to do it. So your list is actually perfect because I'm trying to fill out what the schedule might be. The other thing along those lines is just so people know that Uber does have, I think, an option for handicap accessible, and they also have a pet option if you need to bring a pet somewhere. So it's just, that's something that should be added to. That's it.
Okay. Lou, did you have any comments too?
No, none further.
Okay.
I don't know how you would get a lot of people to come in. We only have a few days of the month that we get a lot of people physically coming in. You know, like Allison can fill in on that, but the day they fold the brochures, the monthly circulars, and the day that Brightview has their dinner and things like that, when we get more people physically in here than usual.
Yeah. So I'm asking all of you just an open question. How serious is this problem of transportation?
Well, if you're not driving, it's pretty darn serious, I think.
Yeah, agree.
I watch our neighbor try to cope with this stuff from time to time. And it can be very frustrating, I think.
Yeah.
It requires a lot of planning and a lot of patience and so forth. So I think, is there anybody in this group that's online at the moment who's not currently driving wherever they want to go?
I bike and I walk.
Okay. Would you, do you also drive?
Yeah, but I try not to.
Okay. And I did not mention biking and
right.
My original list of items had a line item for that, and I just never got to it. Oh, by the way, I regard that list of bulleted points that we went through as a derivative document from the actual written document called Transportation and Seniors that I also sent you last night via email. And Allison, you can resend it if somebody else didn't get it. I had all the email addresses except Susan Schwartz. I did not have one for her.
So, Bobby, if you're still on.
That's the real document. The list of bulleted points is purely derivative from the written document.
I just wanted to add that, I think it is an extremely serious issue. I've worked with a lot of patients as an OT, and that is such a big issue, especially if you don't qualify for the ride. So if you don't qualify for some of these things, because it can be very, very expensive. So if you're just over the eligibility limit for getting the free rides or the low pay rides, it can get very difficult for people to, you know, go to doctor's appointments multiple times a week or doing anything on a regular schedule. It can really add up on a fixed income. So I think that's a very, it's all, you know, all these ideas are good, but I think even with all the options, it still remains to be difficult.
Yeah.
Thank you, Cindy.
Mm-hmm. We used to have a volunteer driving list through the COA. I don't think we have that anymore.
That is something that I would be interested in looking into with a potential new hire that would be dedicated for volunteer things. I mean, that is a piece of work, and it depends if the town is interested in the liability on the driving, which we haven't done for a long time. And with a new town manager, that'd be interesting to see. But it does take coordination. It takes a lot of coordination between the driver and the person and the location and the training. So, yes, I think that's that's an opportunity as well. I also think that we're keeping track of the turndowns for the BLT, the rides that we can't get to, which run between 7 and 10 a month of ones that just overlap and we can't get to them. So that's a piece of data that I'm keeping. And it would be great to have a medical ride shuttle as well, which the Dash kind of turned into, but they didn't reach the goal that they wanted. So that one stopped. So that was really helpful, you know, to get people up to Leahy in a shuttle system and then to Emerson on a different day. So there's definitely need for that. And to Cindy's point, people don't go to their medical appointments and then they end up calling 911 because they haven't taken care of their health. So it does impact the town in a different way. So there's opportunity for all of that. And then to Bobby's point, when we've done a safe driver education through the RMB, we've usually filled the room. So since COVID, a lot of those things have been on Zoom, and I think people would be interested in coming back. So once everything's coming back in person and our rooms are, you know, able to accommodate folks, we can definitely put in a safe driver program.
Yeah, let's keep that on the list.
Sandra has a hand raised too. Do you see that, Alan?
Yes, Sandra.
No, I can't see the hands.
Sandra?
Yeah, thanks. I was just going to mention along Bobby's lines that Neighbor Brigade is available, and also Cindy's comment about people who are who have to go to multiple appointments a week. For example, if they have radiation treatment, you have to go every day, I believe. So I think Neighbor Brigade would step up in that situation. So there are a few resources, and they're actually listed under other transportation resources on the COA website. So that's a very good list of options. So might be worth taking a look at that and reconciling the two documents.
And you just reminded me too, Carton Willard is their at-home program, has transportation available there to go to a shopping a month, I think, and medication, and you can go on their trips too. So
yeah,
part of their program, but that's an option as well. It's kind of like a patchwork of putting things together based on what you need.
Yeah.
And Carlton Willard at home does various things. Don't you have to belong to it in order to use their services?
Yeah. It's a monthly fee to be a part of Carlton Willard at home, and they do multiple, you know, you can schedule drives to different places. I think it's extra and above beyond fee to go into like any of the Boston hospitals or anything out of a certain radius. So
we do that through our Carlton Willard Wheels of Life, the cab. That's what we do. We do
that. Okay.
I missed that, Allison, but I'm sure you remember it. So, so anything
great
else
job
on this topic for right now?
I'm just going to take the information about the need for a medical ride shuttle. It sounds like there's different patchwork opportunities to get medical rides, and they're pretty substantial, but it sounds like we also need a dedicated shuttle. And so I'm going to take that information to the Transportation Advisory Committee just to let them know and just have it in our pocket, like something we need to advocate for.
There's data from the Dash available that says where people were going, and it was medical rides.
Okay, thanks.
I think we're done with this, Alan. Mm-hmm.
Yes, I appreciate the efforts you guys have made. I think we need to put this in a little context, and I don't like to be a naysayer, but I'm just throwing out what I observe, and that is that the predominant mode of transportation is your car, and I thought the highlighting of the refresher for older drivers would be something that would be very useful. I appreciate your comments on that that line. I tried to get my mother to do it, and she nearly cut my head off. And she's since deceased, but she was not happy about giving up her keys. So
mine was not either, Alan.
And I don't know that we'll be any better.
No.
I don't want to give up my keys, but I know it's inevitable at some point. Okay. Any other comments? Questions? Yeah,
would it make sense to, I remember in Bits and Bytes, there were often articles on how to have that conversation. Would that be something we would like to do at the COA, is to how to talk to children of elderly people who might want to have that discussion, as to how to approach it, how not to approach it?
I don't think at the COA would work, but potentially at a library or a different location. You got to kind of put that, get the audience in the right place.
Okay. And another discussion too, maybe a little education. I know Sydney brought up the cost aspects of all these rides. And maybe, I mean, once you give up a car, cars are very expensive to own, maintain, insurance, gas, repairs, all that. If we remind people that this is whatever money you're not spending on your car could be used for this, and it's still a wash. I think a lot of people forget that. They look at it an additional expense as opposed to a replacement expense. So maybe a little education might be useful.
Go ahead. Thanks. So yeah, that seems like that's a great point, Gene. In terms of the conversation that you have with your parents, I think Cindy's point is really well taken. And that's the route I took with my mother, where she had a stroke. And you ask the person to take a test. And my mother's like all over it. Like, of course, I want to do the responsible thing. I'll take a test. And she flunked. She didn't even get into her car. She just flunked the in-room test. So I think providing information about that on our website would be really helpful. Like, you know, where can you get access to a driving test to evaluate yourself or others? Because that makes it really easier. It makes it much easier. It's somebody objectively measuring it, not you trying to convince somebody to give up their keys. And in my case, it worked. My mother was like, I don't know how this happened. I've been driving my whole life, but I guess this is the result. I can't argue with it. So some
people are good like that. Some people do not take it that easily, Sandra.
All right, good to know.
They won't even take the test because they're so afraid they're gonna fail it. And they just want to be able to drive no matter what, kind of thing. And so in those cases, I've made, I've thought of creative ways to take the keys, but in situations of dementia and things like that. But that's a different conversation for a different day.
Keep in mind. Thank you, Sandra. Okay, so Tom and Lou, would you include in your presentation some elements of what would be the next steps here so that we can follow up with this as time unfolds? Okay?
Yeah. Okay.
Tom, you got it?
Yeah.
Very good. Thank you. Okay, moving right along. I did want to raise another item here. We've been approached by a group that's calling or would like to see the Bedford Pops. And I believe the contact was initially made with Bobby. Bobby, are you still there?
And I'm here. I'm here.
Can you help us understand what's being asked here?
Well, what they're looking for is they're hoping that that it would make a difference and add a more of a quality of life in Bedford. And they've had surveys out there, and now with Bedford being part of a cultural district, they feel that they're going to probably need more outdoor large and small, a place for large and small community events. People would maybe use it for music as a theater, something like the Half Shell in Boston. Not that big, but they've narrowed it down to what they want and what they don't want with the and what kind, what people would use it. The school would use it. The different organizations would use it. I have a, I'm looking here, school concerts, award ceremonies, maybe the Chamber of Commerce. They're very interested in having events there, and they thought it would be nice to have a big outdoor place, and people that they've been looking around at, the different communities, I guess, they are very, they work very well, and people love them. And so anyhow, they have, how can the organizations help? I'm looking at a letter here. And they would like to get letters to go presented before the select board and show them how much Bedford could use something like this. I don't know. I'm reading this as I'm talking to you. And they would just like to, they wouldn't know exactly which organizations would use them, but what the, who they've talked to all seem to want it and find that they would use it. So they asked me to call a couple of people, you being one of them. I've sent the same letter to other organizations, and we've got quite a few responses already from people who would like to see this, and it's supposed to be, it's not supposed to cost the taxpayer anything at all, and it's supposed to be self-supporting. So
Bobby, if you know, who would manage this facility?
Who would manage it? Well, I imagine there would be, right now, it's just an, the organization is a Pops Outdoor. I don't know exactly. I know that it would not cost us an annual fee off of taxes or anything like that. I don't know the others. I was reading it, and it sounds great. It really sounds great, and I've been going to the meetings. You kind of caught me off guard here. Let me see who we've gotten. Bedford Day performances, movie nights. They feel the 300th birthday celebration, when that comes in, that we could have probably some events there. I don't know who would manage it on a daily basis. I know maintenance will be part of this too. It's going to cost a lot of money, but it's supposed to be it will pay for itself eventually, and there'll be a lot of PR on it once they get it in front of the select board and have all the questions answered. Where we go from there.
So this group is asking the COA if they would support.
This group is they're not financial support. Just do they think it's a good idea, and would they use it, and any other suggestions that they may have. It would be a permanent outdoor performance space. That's what POP stands for. Mm-hmm. It's a small grassroots working group. It began the process of researching and recommending it to Bedford. It aligns with the Bedford's cultural district now that we're, I don't know, 50 or 51. That's all that there are. And we were just put into this supposedly prestigious organization. They have it for us, even like kids clubs activities, maybe story time, a place to bring kids, the Arts and Crafts Society, the open house during the summer, exhibits. We are asking for community input and support to help us move this project forward and deliver the positive impact this effect will have on Bedford for years to come. That's as far as they've gone. They've been working on it for a while now, and they continue to meet once a month, and hopefully maybe the fall, early fall, they want to bring it to the selectmen. I don't know if now having a new town manager would put a hold on this for a while or not, but they're planning to bring it in front of them.
Anybody else have any comments or questions?
I just had a comment. Go ahead, Tom. I know
that
my Bedford Historical Society Vice President, Paul Percher, has been heavily involved in this thing. And it's important to keep in mind that what they are asking for is a physical facility, because when you see the word Pops, you think about the Boston Pops Orchestra or something like that. That's not what this is. This is a physical facility out there somewhere, which is suitable for this kind of use of small concerts, presentations, that sort of thing. And it seems like a nice idea. And these people have certainly been working on it for a while.
It's got a question too. Bobby, is this a Bedford group that's organizing all this, or is this somebody else?
Yes, it is. No. They're all Bedford residents.
Okay.
It's strictly Bedford.
Okay.
Good. Anyone else?
Yep.
Sandra?
So I think it sounds like a great idea. It feels like if it were created in time for the 350th, maybe that's too far away, Bobby. But I think it sounds like a great idea, and I would love for us to endorse it. I don't know how else we would provide input. I'm really interested in where it might be, you know, what it would look like, all that kind of thing. I can think of two locations. Like, I would love to see Depot Park be a much more intergenerational place where people gather. And then, of course, there's where the summer concerts are behind the common there. But anyway, so, but I think it sounds great.
So, Bobby, Is there a need for some kind of action by the COA?
What we would just like, a letter from the COA stating that we feel that we, you know, think it's a good idea and that we would support it. And Sandra would be hopefully ready for the 300th.
Not the 350th. Yeah, 300th, yeah. I mean, it feels a little bit preliminary to endorse something that we haven't really seen much about, you know, but the idea of pursuing it seems good to me.
Yeah, and they are looking for places now to have it. Hopefully it will be centralized. I have an awful lot of support, a lot of good people on this committee that are working awfully hard to try to get someplace like this to open it up. They have pictures of what they want it to look like. And I had suggested to them maybe they should put some of this out to people to let them see just what we're looking for and what the visual is. But we haven't got that far yet. It's a big job. It's a big job. And I do think in the end that we could rent it out. I think it would be a big plus for Bedford personally, and that's why I'm trying to help in any way I can.
Well, I tend to agree with Sandra's assessment. I like the idea in concept. I'm not sure about how it gets translated into an actual facility and who is going to manage it and for how much. But those are issues down the road, I suspect.
I think what they probably need just enough support to get this into motion, yeah, and have enough PR in Bedford for people to start endorsing it, finding ways to support it, or getting on a committee and move it along.
Yeah. Do you want to make a motion?
You talking to me?
Yes. Yeah.
I would make a motion that the Bedford COA will support. I'm looking here. Let me see. To the members, what they're going to do is they're going to make a proposal to hear about a proposal to bring a permanent outdoor performance space, POPS, to Bedford's new cultural district. Adding a sheltered performance space to Bedford will enable the community to enjoy a wider range of performances, events, activities, and festivals. Having more cultural events and community gatherings increases the vitality of our town and will be a net benefit to Bedford. So something to that effect would be nice to have in writing if we can support it as the from the Bedford COA.
I'll second that.
I'm not sure what the motion would be here, other than to support the concept of the Bedford POPS.
I think it's just to support the proposal.
Is that close? Yeah.
Like you said, I'm not sure we can support the whole, we can't. I think just to say we would like to see where it's going kind of thing. So to support the proposal of this, and to hear more about it, something along those lines, in a more better worded,
Bobby,
of course.
Bobby, if there's no urgent need here, could we invite some representative from this group to come to one of our board meetings?
Yes, I can. I'll ask probably Paul Percher. He's the one that sent me the letter, and he's kind of heading this up. Ask him to come and maybe get on our agenda. Is that what you would prefer?
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. So that we would have a little more of an idea about what they're after and what would be useful to them.
Okay, why don't I talk to Paul and have him get in touch either with you, Alan, or to send some kind of a letter to us, and we can go from there.
That would be terrific, Bobby.
Would that be better? Okay. I'll take care of that with Paul and have, if, do you know Paul?
I don't.
Paul Percher? You don't. Okay. Well, I will have him get in touch with you and try to get on our next agenda, if there's room.
Yep. That would be excellent.
Okay.
Thank you.
I'll do that. I'll do that, Alan.
So with that, I'm suggesting that we withdraw the motion. Is that acceptable to you?
Yes. Okay. We withdraw it until we
hear from.
From the committee, from a member of the committee. Okay. Right. I'll relay that message.
Okay. Cindy, since you seconded it, would you withdraw your
second? I will withdraw my second. Yep, no problem.
Thank you, Cindy.
No problem.
Okay. And we shall see if we can schedule them. Excuse me, I'm making a note. Sorry. Okay. As I indicated earlier, Bopa had indicated to me that she would be unable to be here today. Are there any other liaisons that wish to speak? Is there anybody else here?
Well, I just, from the FBCOA, we were taking a lot of trips, doing a lot of socials, and they're all filled, and people are thrilled with what's going on. We had tea in Lexington, and we had I don't know, I think almost 20 people. We had a bus trip. The bus was filled. We have two or three things coming up now. And it's become a lot more social with a lot more people attending and calling us and participating. So I think we're growing.
Okay. Anybody have any questions for Bobby?
No, but thank you, Bobby. I so appreciate that you've been doing that for so many years, and it sounds really exciting.
Yeah, we have a bus trip going on, and we're talking about a tour. So hopefully we'll be able to keep this going. It's I've expanded the committee, and I've got some good leaders on there that really leading the group. We're having we had an ice cream social, which I guess you knew, and we're going to have something after our meeting next week. And we had a breakfast, complimentary breakfast all planned, but it was the day of the snowstorm, so we'll have to reschedule that. And people are looking forward to asking questions and looking forward to our next event.
Very good. Anyone else? Okay. Our next meeting, which is misidentified on the agenda for today, should be May 9th, not April 11th, which is today. So I didn't notice that until this morning. So if you'll make that correction. We will meet on Zoom, although keep in mind that requirement is flexible, and we may not continue on Zoom forever. So think about whether or not we want to go back to face-to-face. Next month, we've got Gene, who is going to share with us part of what he was mentioning earlier about the video clips. I'm intrigued by that, and I was aware of it, thanks to Gene's keeping me informed. And we look forward to hearing more about it. And in a general discussion about communication and messaging, which is a serious problem, continues to be. Okay, any other comments or questions before we close? No? Is there a motion to adjourn?
So made.
Second.
Thank you, Lou. Who seconded?
I second that, Bobby.
Bobby, okay. No, so we should go back to roll call. So Lou, how do you vote on the yes. motion?
Yes.
Thank you. Sandra?
Yes.
Tom?
Yes.
Bobby?
Yes.
Gene?
Yes.
Cindy, did I get you?
Not yet. Yes, no. I.
Sorry about that.
That's all right.
So, Cindy?
Yes.
Okay. And I vote yes as well. Okay. Thank you all.
Thank you.
See you later. Okay.